sahanavavatu, sahanau bhunaktu, sahaviryam karvavahai, tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shantihi.
Namaskar. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Vivekananda International Foundation, I extend to you a very hearty welcome to this Vimarsh series of events. And today we are having a panel discussion to commemorate Swami Vivekananda's 155th birth anniversary. We have with us a very distinguished panel of experts who will speak to us today on the relevance of Swami Vivekananda's message to contemporary times, to present-day problems, and to India and to Indians in general. Before I make my introductory remarks, I would like to introduce my distinguished panelists. Shri Swapan Dasgupta is well known to you, a member of parliament and a columnist for major Indian newspapers, a PhD in history from School of Oriental and African Studies, London, and a former research fellow of Nuffield College, Oxford. A journalist for 30 years, he has occupied senior editorial positions in Times of India, Indian Express, and India Today. He writes regular columns for Times of India, Telegraph, and Pioneer, and is a commentator on TV18 network. He is a member of the Executive Council of Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, a director of India Foundation, member of Advisory Council of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Research Foundation, and a member of the Press Council of India. In 2015, he was awarded the Padma Bhushan by the President of India and nominated to the Rajya Sabha. We have a very distinguished panelist in Dr. K. Subrahmanyam. He has a long list of achievements, so I'll have to abridge it a little bit. He is the Dean of Swami Vivekananda Yoga Anusandhan Samsthan, Yoga University, Bangalore, where he is the Pro-Chancellor of the university. He's also the Chairman, Academic Council, Vivekananda Educational Society, Chennai, President Vivekananda Academy of Cultural Studies, Kanyakumari, Member General Body, Vivekananda Kendra, Kanyakumari, Faculty, Vivekananda Institute of Human Excellence, Hyderabad, Director, Vivekananda Academy of Civil Services, Hyderabad, Member, Yoga Education, UGC, Advisor, Vivekananda College, Madurai. He is an author of, I was just counting how many books he has written, I think 18 books and over 200 articles. And he has covered a variety of topics, spiritual topics, many of these. He's written on, for instance, Bhishma, Maharishi Hanuman, Vibhuti Vivekananda, significance of avatars. He has written commentaries on Bhajagovindam and many, many other things. He is educationist of repute, and he was telling me he is presently engaged with the UGC in formulating curriculum on yoga, which would be introduced in central universities and many other colleges. Perhaps in some places it has already been introduced. Then we have young Dr. Anirban Ganguly, the director of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Research Foundation, which is a Delhi-based think tank. Dr. Ganguly is a scholar of civilization, history, politics, and culture, and is a member of Central Advisory Board of Education, Ministry of Human Resource Development, member of the Governing Board of Auroville Foundation, member of the Vishwa Bharati Sansad Court, Shantiniketan. He holds PhD in education from Jadavpur University, Kolkata, and his early education was at Sri Aurobindo International Center of Education, Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Puducherry. He has authored, edited, co-edited several books, and some of these are Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, His Vision of Education, 2017, The Modi Doctrine, New Paradigm in India's Foreign Policy, 2016, Redefining Governance, Essays on 1 Year of Narendra Modi Government, 2015, Swami Vivekananda, Buddha and Buddhism, 2014, Debating Culture, 2013. I must say, I just finished reading this book on debating culture a few days ago, and it's a wonderful book and worth a read. Everybody who wants to know about what the debates on Indian culture were, I think this is a very educative, informative book. And then is a book on education, philosophy, and practice, 2011. How he managed to achieve so much in such young age, of course, is something that you should ask him. So we have this very distinguished panel to discuss what they think about the relevance of Swami Vivekananda and his message today. Today, India is at a unique moment in history. We stand at the threshold of reclaiming our prominent place in the Committee of Nations. We are on course to overtake United Kingdom and Germany and become the third largest economy in the world. Soon it will become the most populous nation in the world as well. But India's greatness does not come from its economic growth or size. It comes from its old civilization and civilizational and spiritual values. In 1893, when Swamiji was speaking at Chicago at the World Parliament of Religions, India was colonized and poor. But Swamiji told the world with tremendous confidence and conviction and self-belief that India was a rich culture and Hinduism was a broad-based and inclusive religion. Vedanta philosophy was in tune with the findings of the modern science, he told them. He also told his audience that Ekam Vipra Bahudha Vadanti, truth was one, but ways to seek the truth were different. He pointed out a common thread running through different religions, and he quoted Lord Krishna, who said, and I quote, "I am in every religion as a thread through a string of pearls," unquote. Vivekananda said, "The great central truth of all religion is to evolve a god out of man." So that is the kind of a vision that he had. Swamiji was not just a religious or a spiritual monk. He was a person of immense practicality as well. He realized that India had enough of religions. Millions of Indians of his time were stricken by poverty and famine, and they needed food. He spoke thus, and I quote, "They ask us for bread, and we give them stones. It is an insult to a starving people to offer them religion." So you could see, while on one hand there was a focus on religion and spiritual values, civilization values, but you could not overlook the misery, the plight in which the people were, and they needed, at that point of time, food. Caste has been a scourge in India. It has vitiated the politics of India, and Vivekananda spoke about caste thus. In religion, there is no caste. Caste is simply a social institution. Swamiji spoke about rejuvenation of India with great passion. India needs another round of rejuvenation now. India should no doubt have material wealth and physical power. No one takes meek and weak seriously. But India's confidence must come from its ancient civilization and deep spirituality. intractable problems of today can be dealt better if principles of spirituality were applied to them. In today's world, we see a lot of conflict. The war in the Middle East has claimed, the wars in Middle East have claimed millions of lives. Terrorism is spreading like wildfire and poses grave threat to peace and security. Nuclearized Korean Peninsula is in the midst of heightened tensions amidst daily threats of use of nuclear weapons. Identity politics has vitiated the Indian polity badly. How does one get over or at least reduce the misery in the world? The PM has spoken of Vasudev Kutumbakam, Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, and many other such thoughts as underlying the foreign policy of India. How does one realize these aims? Can international politics be infused with spirituality, or is it a mere wishful thinking? What is the relevance of Swamiji's message to the modern world? These are some of the questions I hope our panelists will cover today in their remarks. So I will now request Shri Swapan Dasgupta to make each panelist to make 10 minutes remarks, and then we will open up the discussion, and I'll invite the audience also to participate, and then we'll have a second round of discussion.
Thank you, Arvindji. My distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's a great honor to be invited to speak on Swamiji on the occasion of his birth anniversary. I think it's very important when we take into account the contribution, the legacy of Swamiji, to realize that almost 115 years or so after his death, he remains a formidable icon of India, and indeed very much of the entire Hindu civilization. And yet here was a man who died when he was 39 years old. A man who died at 39 years old. So the point is, what would have been his contribution? It's a good deal of counterfactual history as to what would have been his contribution had he lived longer. Now, Swamiji was a very unique sort of a man. He doesn't correspond to certain stereotypes. He was a great, accomplished singer. He had a very refined aesthetic sense. He was not strictly a vegetarian. He loved his fish. He loved his cheroot after dinner, for which there were a lot of snide comments which were made by contemporary society at that time. So he was not, in any sense of the term, a stereotype of what we would call the Hindu monk, which is how his picture is often made out to be in the early part of the 20th century, how he was described as. Yet, Swamiji, I think, epitomized a lot of the yearnings of India at a particular time. Therefore, to understand him fully, to understand why he clicked, why his message resonated, I think it's important to understand also a little bit of the context in which he operated. Because no man actually can be freed of the historical context in which they operate. And it's important to realize that the most profound question which preoccupied people, particularly the thinking individuals, at least of the three presidencies, if not in the rest of the country, was one fundamental question. Why is India a subject nation? And it was the various answers to this very question, which really directed how we moved in the rest. And every one of them had their own sense of what. I mean, we know some of them, and some of them wanted the history about it, the disunity, the political disunity, et cetera, et cetera. And I think there's a certain degree of commonality about what thing. What was Swamiji's particular contribution in the course of the next having taken up about 3-4 minutes, let me just summarize in the thing. What I feel are the main contributions of Swamiji and why he will be remembered. The most important contribution of Swamiji, and given the context, was that he restored to Hindus a sense of their own sovereignty, a sense of their own pride. If you look at the Chicago address, what is important is not merely what he said, but that it was said for the first time by a person oozing self-confidence and talking in the idiom with which people were there. So here was a subject people who thought somehow being Hindu was somehow being, you know, second raters, we are pagans, we are somewhere below the, we are sometime below the fold. And here was a man who went around and said that here we are. We are the proud inheritors of the oldest civilization. We are proud. And we have no reason whatsoever to be defensive about ourselves. So the idea of what has now come to be popularized as the garv se kaho hum Hindu hai was actually a derivative from the essence of what Swamiji said, that there is no reason for you to be defensive. And for Hindus, he restored and brought to the fore, and he was not the only person, but he certainly was one of the principal persons, a sense of emotional sovereignty. And that, to my mind, is something which played a very, very important role in building up the entire freedom struggle. Without that sense, there would have been no self-confidence, there would have been no freedom struggle. It's a different matter what has happened since independence. I'm not going to go into that. But it is important that the recognition of Swamiji as perhaps the foremost Hindu activist should be recognized. That's the first one. These days, of course, much of the collected works of Swamiji, alas, have, in a sense, sometimes been selectively edited. I won't say censored. And some portions of it have been conveniently omitted. It would be a worthwhile exercise, someone, to actually restore the unexpurgated version of what Swamiji said and wrote. The second issue, which I think Swamiji should be remembered for, is that the Hindu tradition had somehow taken into account that this religion, that our faith, is divided into two parts. One, there is a social custom in which caste plays a very important role, and there is spiritualism in which we become individuals. One of the reasons why Hindus have perhaps the least sense of history is because we have often thought that our experiences are our own. There is no need for it to transmit it. We must all undergo those experiences all over again with our teachers. So every individual must go through that. And therefore, there was a retreat from the public sphere. Swamiji, for the first time, enlarged the vision of what constitutes Hindu and brought it into the sphere of activism. He linked your being a Hindu to you creating the nation. Nation building and Hinduism were linked. And he was the first person who actually explicitly drew that linkage and brought in the notion of activism. The notion of Daridra Narayan, which he highlighted for the first time, it's subsequently been popularized by various other things. The sense that it is important to reach out to those who've been forgotten and who have been trampled on by society, which later, in his own way, Gandhiji also took up. Swamiji in his own first being. That to be a saffron-clad monk does not mean you only retreat into the monastery. It means that you're out on the field. That sense of activism was brought forth. And therefore, when we remember Swami Vivekananda, the contribution he made. It is to remember him as a person who, in a sense, redefined the Hindu tradition almost totally. He had various other contributions that I'm sure they'll be spoken about. But to my mind, why Swami Vivekananda remains the inspiration today, so many, is not only because there is a Ramakrishna mission. Sometimes the Ramakrishna mission works in its own philosophies, which is sometimes very little to do with Swamiji. But it is because he inspired, he was the inspiration, to my mind, the real symbolic inspiration behind many of those who sacrificed their lives for the country and who brought about freedom and who propelled people to actually believe that there is a destiny of India. And some of that, I'm glad to say, is returning to the map of India today. Thank you very much.
Esteemed elders and my dear friends, Swami Vivekananda's contribution is immense. Not only did he glorify Daridra Devo Bhava, he has also glorified Murkha Devo Bhava. These Murkhas are responsible for the downfall of this country. Murkha is one who is educated in the modern world with degrees, titles, without any insight into the glory of this country, without patriotism, without the willingness to have an open mind. A close-minded man is supposed to be a murkha, an idiot. And these so-called highly qualified people are first and foremost to be educated. India is subjected to the foreign rule chiefly because of our closed minds. When he wanted arise awake, he wanted us to open our minds and make ourselves fit to be the Indians. This education which we have been following now is Macaulayan. Modern education is at three levels, primary, secondary, and higher. The goal of the primary education at present is 3 R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. At the secondary level, it is something of everything. A little of history, a little of economics, a little of botany, zoology, history, economics, commerce, computer science, etc. At the higher level, everything of something, nothing to do beyond the modern relevance. Materialistic, body-bound, self-centered, money-making, professional education. And this education of the present age can be categorized into 4: useful education, useless education, nuisance education, and dangerous education. Dangerous education causes terrorism. Nuisance education is a botheration to the parents, to the teachers, to the society, eve-teasing, etc. That is what is most relevant now in the country. Useless education, full many a gem of purest race in the dark unfathomed caves of ocean bare, full many a flower is born to blush unseen on the desert air. Talent hunt is not fully alert, is not fully bright. It is still in darkness. Many talented people are unable to come to the surface, and therefore their contribution to the country is totally absent. That is what we have, useless education. Useful education is that which is not only money-making, bread-bringing, but soul-elevating and patriotic. All realms, at all levels, at all times, to all people, it should be useful. To give a categorical example, Rama's education in the Ramayana is useful to all. Ekalavya's education is useless. Jayadradha's education is a nuisance. Karna's education is a terroristic, caused Mahabharata Yuddha. And what is the right education? Education can be broadly categorized into aparavidya and paravidya. Aparavidya is the modern education, B.Tech, M.Tech, MBBS, MS, MD, CA, Law. All these degrees, these are all aparavidya. A professional efficiency is not sufficient to face the problems of life. The financial problems, the domestic problems, social problems, moral problems, ethical problems, psychological problems, intellectual problems. We are confronted by hundreds and hundreds of problems. An engineer cannot face the problem in the kitchen. He is scared of the cockroach in the kitchen. A brigadier on the battlefield is shivering in shoes when he faces the puny creature in the kitchen. And all this is because we are not initiated into paravidya. And what does paravidya mean? Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvade. Arjuna is trained in professional education. He is very good at archery. And he is unable to face the problem. Not that he is incapacitated to fight. Not that he is less proficient in archery. He is very good scholar, engineer, doctor. Every proficiency he has. But at the sight of his friends, brothers, teachers, and the elders, he became nervous. He is anxiety ridden. He is tension ridden. And how many officers are stressed now? It is not your knowledge of the subject. It is not the proficiency in the field of specialization that gives us the strength of mind and confidence to face the problems of life. And the entire Bhagavad Gita, Kshudram Hridaya Daurbalyam Tyaktvottishta Parantapa. It is a psychic weakness that has made Arjuna incapacitated to face the problem. However proficient we may be in our fields of expertise in knowledge, there is required strength. Strength at every level, confidence. And that confidence, when it is revived, it's called paravidya. And that paravidya is Yoga Shastra, Brahma Vidya, as we find at the end of each chapter, Srimad Bhagavad Gita Upanishads. And it is Yoga Shastra. Yoga is not physical postures. Yoga is not performing asanas. Yoga is at every level, physical, psychological, intellectual, sociological, etc., etc., etc. And it is not only for this world, it is after the death too. And that paravidya, when it is initiated into the educational curriculum, people will be in a position to establish themselves in the field of psychic strength, confidence. In the interviews, we see how the boy or girl is able to ooze the confidence. If we are subjected to the foreign rule, that confidence is reduced. It has been made low in our hearts. And therefore, Kshudram Hridaya Daurbalyam. When it gives that psychic strength, it is paravidya. You take two examples. In the Mahabharata, we have Abhimanyu. In the womb, he is given the professional education by his father, Arjun, archery. How to enter into Padma Vyuha or Chakra Vyuha. How to expand our territories. How to enter into the problems. We do not know how to come out of the problems. We know how to create a family. We know how to increase our family problems, financial problems. We go on expanding, and getting caught in the clutches of the world. We do not know how to come out of it. Abhimanyu has been able to enter into the Padma Vyuha, he is unable to come out of it. So also we enter into the problems of this world at every level. We do not know how to detach ourselves from them. We do not know how to withdraw. We do not know how to come out. When we do not know how to come out, we do not know how to face the problems as well. The just opposite. Prahlad is also a boy in the mother's womb. And he is brought up in the Maharshi's ashram, Narada Maharshi. An educational environment is created there. Paravidya is initiated there. The baby in the womb is taught Narayana Nama Mantra. That does not mean a sort of a bhajan or an escapism. The excellent Paravidya ability to face the problems. How many problems the boy Prahlad has faced? Never has he fallen. Never has he wept. Never has he become nervous. Abhimanyu is caught. Prahlada is able to face. The reason for Prahlada's ability to face the problems, come out of the problems successfully, it is all because of the excellent environment created, and that is Paravidya. Are we able to establish that environment in the universities and colleges? Are we able to make the children face the problems of the world? And that is what is required. The entire Bhagavad Gita is swallowed by Narendranath, Swami Vivekananda, and he has come out with four beautiful books. One is Rajyoga, the other Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, and Jnana Yoga. Of the four, only one book he sat at the desk and wrote, and that is Rajyoga. The remaining three books are his lectures. The only one book which he sat at the desk with a pen and paper he wrote, and that is Rajyoga. If only we are capable of introducing Rajyoga and the remaining three, every student, every individual in this country will be in a position to face the problems of life, solve the problems for the benefit of society. Ideal Indian educational system should have three goals. One is ability to face the problem, ability to solve the problem, ability and magnanimity to solve the problem for the benefit of both posterity and others, and then it is Paravidya. At present, we have only a Paravidya. We should be happy and we will be grateful to the government of India if only it can introduce Paravidya into our educational curriculum. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, I request Dr. Ganguly to make his remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. You asked a question right at the beginning that in such a short span, how have I been able to do so much? I think it's not much that I have done, but whatever little I have done, most of it I have done when I was here in the IR. Wow. I think after that I have done mighty less, which is original in that sense. You use the word expert. I'm not speaking about the others, but when I speak about myself, I was trying to visualize Swamiji's face when you know, even somebody was called an expert on him. I think he also had a major problem if somebody referred to Sri Ramakrishna as Lord Sri Ramakrishna. He would laugh it off. And there's a very interesting point. Dr. Dasgupta mentions his love for fish. It's very interesting if you read Mary Louise Burke's Swami Vivekananda in the West, she describes the childlike joy and insistence that he had. He wanted to go up in the hot air balloon when he visited Switzerland, and it was already evening. They did a round and came down, and he insisted he wanted to go back. And next day he made sure he probably went up three times in the hot air balloon. And then they trekked all the way from Chamonix to this Saint Bernard Abbey. And he wanted to go and see how that abbey runs. He spoke to Pierre Chanu, who was the father there. And then he was interested also in buying St. Bernard puppies. and bringing them back to India. And they say, luckily, they were all sold off, so he could not lay his hands on some of them. I just want to make a few points, primarily because this morning I came across a line of Swami Vivekananda where he says, my mission is to generate a struggle in you. So the whole morning I was feeling that struggle while trying to prepare and think of what to say. There are about four points that have come to me in the sense in course of, and I think each of these points could be turned into probably a full-length book or a full-length study on Swami Vivekananda. One is our interpretation and articulation of ourselves. I think it is important because we are living in a global society. Globalization is taking place. And so you cannot escape getting connected to the world. But at the same time, what Swami Vivekananda emphatically emphasized was the capacity to develop this capacity of making our own estimation of ourselves, our civilization, and our culture. And I think his was the first challenge to an interpretation of ourselves, which was externally articulated, disseminated, and regulated. And I think I want to just read out this interesting sentence that he had. And he asked himself, have we not then to learn anything from the West? And he goes on asking these questions. And he says, certainly we have things to learn from the West. He himself did it. He himself absorbed so much from the West. But, and then he recalled a very interesting anecdote. He said, a certain young man of little understanding used always to blame the Hindu Shastras before Sri Ramakrishna. One day, he praised the Bhagavad Gita, on which Sri Ramakrishna said, methinks some European Pandit has praised the Gita, and so he also follows suit. And I think that contains a tremendous amount of wisdom. Our understanding of ourselves, one of the byproducts, one of the primary byproducts of colonization, was this, that our understanding of ourselves, our evaluation of ourselves, was made by an external agency, and we had surrendered ourselves to that external agency. A colonized civilization loses the knowledge of its knowledge systems and control over its articulation. The other interesting point, the second point, Swamiji talks about contraction of expression. He says that the West, for example, was primarily drawn out of the Greek civilization, which had a tremendous capacity to express itself. And then in India, he says, unfortunately, sometimes we think so deeply that there's no power left for expression. Gradually, therefore, it came to pass that our force of expression did not manifest itself before the world. Without expression, how can we live? The backbone of Western civilization is expansion and expression. So, I'm just leaving you with these thoughts. And then, of course, throughout his travels across the world, what comes out is when you study Swami Vivekananda, especially the peripatetic traveler, he's trying to discern, he's trying to look for, he's trying to investigate, examine Indianness everywhere, wherever he goes. And if you see, starting from his first visit to the West, his letters to Alasinga Perumal from Hong Kong, he describes that. And then right up to 1900, when he visits Paris, he describes that as well. So there's this constant quest of trying to discover traces of India across the world. And I think that is important for us. When we look at Swami Vivekananda and India's soft power, it is very important to realize that he was perhaps the first one who created, who tried to create a civilizational grand narrative for India, and who tried to instill into us a sense of Indian exceptionalism at a period when we were thoroughly colonized and materially under subjection, intellectually dominated. So it's very interesting, you know, if you look at his sojourn, his last sojourn in Paris in 1900, where he went to attend the Exposition Universelle Internationale, he sees, he absorbs, and he spoke at the World Congress there also, he absorbs the latest material development of the West as was presented in that exhibition, and he makes minute observations. In fact, two of his seminal texts, Memoirs of European Travel and East and West, must be standard reading for those of us who are trying to understand Swami Vivekananda's projection of India's soft power. And in fact, it's very interesting, in the East and West, he even talks about the shawls that Empress Eugenie preferred, and how those shawls came from Kashmir, and how during Napoleon III's reign, the Kashmiri shawl was a rage in Parisian salons. And then he says how the Kashmiri shawl dealer and trader and seller was benefiting at that point of time. Now, for Swami Vivekananda, he left many things undone. I mean, incomplete. It's very interesting, the fourth point, it was found in his papers. He had proposed a book, India's Message to the World. And it's a very interesting book. I mean, it's a very interesting, it's exactly like we do. We prepare a synopsis, we have the numbers, we make the points which we want to then elaborate. Perhaps there were 42 points that he has written down. And I think each point, perhaps he wanted to turn them into a chapter. So a book written by Swami Vivekananda, India's Message to the World, containing 42 chapters, and in each of these, he has tried to articulate a fundamental dimension of Indian civilization. And you know, it's very interesting. He starts with the second point. He says, 4 years of residence in the marvelous West has made India only be better understood. And very interestingly, in the third point, he says that his survey of Western civilization has also convinced him that it is not true that Indians have degenerated. This is something very interesting. And then, of course, he goes on, you know, he describes, you know, point 29, he talks about monotheism. You spoke about Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vatanti. So point 30, he says, that is how we tackled monotheism in India. And then he goes on. And there's a very interesting point he makes in point 39. He says, principles of Vedanta should be taught not only in India, but also outside. Our thoughts must enter into the makeup of the minds of every nation. To conclude, because Swami Vivekananda and India's soft power is really as vast as soft power itself, but the concept of a civilizational grand narrative for India, that India was a civilizational power, which was as distinct from powers which were hegemonistic. Swami Vivekananda finds everywhere soft penetrations of India's civilizational attributes, and emphasis that India had a global reach in the past and that global reach and narrative had to be rediscovered and restated in the present. There's a lot of talk of Confucianism pushing forward a certain narrative. I think Swami Vivekananda can be an equally, if not extremely more powerful, I don't want to use the word instrument, but energy, to push forward the Indian narrative of civilization. And I think it is very important, and Swami Vivekananda provides the way forward, that we should have not only a theory, but we should also have a praxis, a time-bound praxis of how to go about and achieve this soft power vision that he, in a span of about 3 years of extensive travel, could really articulate. So as I always say, I do not know whether I've been able to really express myself. But these were some thoughts. Contraction of expression, control of our estimate and articulation of ourselves, then the articulation of a civilizational grand narrative with India at the center, and an abiding sense of Indian exceptionalism in this age and time. And I think that is what is one of Swami Vivekananda's constant self-renewing message before us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you have had three excellent presentations. All of them have made some very relevant points. They have told us about, they have thrown some light on Swami Vivekananda's personality, his message, the context in which he was working, and also its relevance for today. Now, I would like to make it interactive, so we are requested, I would request you to take some slips, send your questions here. I've already got a large number of questions, and I think the second round would be centered around these questions, and I think you will collect the questions. So anybody who wants to send a question, just raise their hand, they will just collect it from you. In the meanwhile, I'll come to you. That let's first make some questions so that we have a little more out of our panelists who are otherwise, we have only a limited time. So let me just, I'll come to you for your comment if there is some time permitting. So I'll read out a few questions together so that you can take them all together. This is to Dr. Swapan Das Gupta. How the Hindu religion and customs as envisaged by Swamiji can be effectively used to solve the present social problems and fight the divisive forces and bring the society together? This is from Air Marshal Bajpai. Then there is another to Dr. Swapan Das Gupta. Respected sir, explore your thoughts on Mahatma Gandhi's, Veer Savarkar's, and Vivekananda's Hinduism. Do their views on Hinduism reflect on today's Indian politics? This is from one Mr. Sagar Patil. Then there is a question, why is India gradually forgetting Swamiji's teachings? We remember him only on certain days. The Indian youth seem to misunderstand his views. Is this true? How could we overturn that? This is from Abhinav. Then there is one Mr. Abhay Rajput who says, I understand that Swamiji had done for Hindus. I understand what Swamiji had done for Hindus, but here I wanted to know that what he has done for human beings. Then there is one from J.P. Shukla. What is the view of panelists, this is to all, that there should be a Vivekananda Yuva Kendra or center in all villages, towns, districts of all states of our country? And then there is one from Mr. Dipankar. Why does the Indian history textbooks continue to ignore the contribution of Swamiji? Is cultural and spiritual unification not an important contribution towards demand for India's struggle for freedom? This is from Dipankar. Then there is one question from Rajan Kumar. Is being Hindu more important or being a human? If Swamiji is born today, what would he like to be, a Hindu or a human? And then there is a question on what is soft power. So these are some of the questions, and then I'll come for, after you have all spoken, then I'll take some comments as well. Yes, maybe you start with it.
Okay. So that's quite a galaxy of questions, some of them which are completely unanswerable.
So audience is doing well.
And some which will require an entire day to answer. But however, let me just think, I was intrigued by the question about humans and Hindus. Somehow thinking we are something less than human, which obviously means that Swamiji's work was somewhere incomplete and the message didn't quite filter through adequately. Now, the larger issue of how Indian, I mean, if I'm right in saying, how can Swamiji, how can Indian customs, or rather, how can the message of Swamiji be used to fight casteism? Is that what it was exactly?
Yes.
Social problems,
social,
yeah.
Social problems.
You know, I mean, I think really the thrust of Swamiji, which he was really very clear about, was that the role of what he saw as religion could not be detached and disengaged from the other evils of society, number one. And number two, he identified many of the problems which are there in India as being a direct consequence of our close engagement with our own faith. When he called Kerala a madhouse of castes, he was actually referring, and that didn't come out of nowhere. It came out of the particular traditions of Kerala, most of which was religion. So to that extent, here was Swamiji who actually believed that there is no such thing as fixed customs, there is no such thing as timeless tradition, that everything has to be really brought about to what is the cause of nation building for the moment. And that really brings up to that question which I posed first, as to what exactly the question he asked, why is India subordinate? Why has India lost its freedom? Why has India lost its sovereignty? And those are the very issues which he says, that's because you also, to recover your self-esteem, you've got to treat people with dignity and restore their sense of dignity. And some of that indignity has been caused by the religious customs itself. So while he actually venerated the traditions of Hinduism, he was also sharply critical of it. He was sharply critical to such an extent, for instance, he was unsparing, for example, in his attack on missionaries. I mean, this is sometimes very forgotten, that in the late 19th century, particularly the in Bengal, where Swamiji did most of his work, the much of the Hindu social reform movement came as a direct consequence of the missionary activity. And so his attacks were very much that he didn't want, and at the same time, there is a very famous line in Prabuddha Bharat, which he wrote at that time, and he talked about people leaving the Hindu fold are not merely one Hindu less, but one enemy the more. A very contentious one, which these days no one wants to refer to because it has its own associations. But it's important to remember that at that time, so while reforming Hinduism, he, or the Hindu faith, the Hindu traditions, He was also sharply critical of anyone who wanted to get out of it, because he saw that as central to what India was. And, you know, how is Gandhi, Savarkar and Vivekananda different? I think there are various ways in which we can talk about it. They come from very, very different traditions. Savarkar was entirely political. Savarkar was an atheist. He was a political Hindu, and a very committed political Hindu. He equated Hindu with nationality. And he was always unflinching on that. Gandhiji's Hinduism came very much from the Vaishnav tradition. Vivekananda came, but a bit from the Brahmo, bit from the Shakta. That's a curious mixture. It's a very Bengali mixture. And the biggest difference, perhaps, I would say, you could get a clue of it. Vivekananda very rarely spoke directly about politics to that extent. Mm-hmm. Often he has been called the non-political patriotism. The implications of it have always been political, but he spoke very directly. But there is this oft-quoted thing about him talking about a Hindu mind and an Islamic body. What he meant didn't mean that the body of the Muslims was certainly better, but what he meant was there has a sense of organization and a sense of aggression which was lacking in Hindu and which he celebrated. Gandhi, on the other hand, saw virtue in passivity, and he elevated passivity to the level of truth. Both are traditions which are central to the Hindu tradition, but they come from very different places. And I think that, in a sense, I would say, in a nutshell, as to why the complexities of Swamiji have not been further elaborated in history, I think because there is an attempt, a conscious attempt to sanitize Swamiji. And I think this is this whole attempt of making everything universal, making him a universal God-man. Now, I think there is a place for universal God-man, but I personally don't believe that Swami Vivekananda was one of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Friends, among the questions, there is one: is Swamiji a humanist or a Hindu? If at all he is to be born next, would he like to be born as a Hindu or a humanist? Which would he prefer? That's one of the questions. I would like to answer that. Humanism and Hinduism are not separate. They are one and the same. And in his own statement, we find Hindu universalism, Islamic solidarity, Christian self-sacrifice. Hindu universalism includes every ism. In fact, his first speech, "I thank you in the name of Mother of Religions." When he uses that word, mother, he means Hinduism, which is the mother of all religions. It is universalism. Hindu very often is considered to be a mild Hindu. Instead of being humanist, we are more human than what we require to be. That is the problem. And Swami Vivekananda himself said, "I would like to be born again and again and again, as long as there are widows, as long as there are orphans, I would like to wipe the tears of the widow. I would like to restore the glory and strength to those who are less privileged." And this is the real fact about Swami Vivekananda. And he is, once after his return from Chicago, from the foreign tour, there was a conversation among the Gurubhais in Belur Math. Girish Chandra Ghosh asked him, "Mr. Vivekananda, are you a spiritual giant?" The way he asked him, Swamiji was shaken. "No." "Are you a great freedom fighter?" "No." "Are you a Hindu monk of India?" "No." What are you? Then Vivekananda says, you know what I am. Mr. Vivekananda, I know you are first and foremost a humanist. On the 11th of September, when you became a global personality, that night the great people of Chicago came to your chamber. They showered encomiums on you. They gave you gift after gift. By the time they left, it was about 11 o'clock that night. And that day, what did you do? I rolled on the floor and wept profusely, remembering the people of my country. And that night, I composed two sentences. One, him I call a Mahatma whose heart bleeds for the poor, and that is Hinduism. And the second sentence he composed on the 11th of September in the midnight, he did not eat, he did not sleep, he rolled on the floor and wept profusely. Him I call a Duratma, him I call a traitor, him I call a Drohi, him I call a scoundrel, who having been educated at the cost of millions and millions of poor people with their taxpayer payment, you have qualified yourself and you have forgotten your fellow human beings. Him I call a Duratma. He is unfit to be called a Hindu. Him I call a Mahatma. For the first time, a Mahatma is defined. And Girish Chandra goes, pays the compliment. I am glad, Vivekananda, you are essentially a humanist, a Hindu humanist. Hinduism and humanism are identical. They are not to be separated. If one person is not a humanist, he ceases to be called a Hindu. Hinduism and humanism are one and the same. Thank you.
Soft power is the power of your cultural repositories, tangible, intangible, your philosophy, your knowledge systems, your aesthetics, the physical expressions of all of these, everything put together that has evolved over the centuries and which have been passed on from generation to generation. As K. Munshi would say, passed on from the, preserved by the dominant minority and passed on from generation to generation. The capability of recognizing these and of putting them to use to achieve your present day strategic civilizational objectives is what soft power is all about. I'm not quoting Joseph Nye because it's cliched. But there have been great thinkers, Ananda Kumaraswamy, to name just one. K.M. Munshi, while creating the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, to name another, who have actually utilized this. Can this be done at the policy level? Can it be done in a more systematic and coherent manner? There are countries who are doing it. And I think, being one of the oldest civilizations, we should be conscious of that and consciously try and project it. Hard power, there are many hawks here in Vivekananda International Foundation. I've had a number of debates with them in the past. Hard power is a necessity. Hard power, soft power without hard power is obviously a non-starter, but there has to be a balancing and a blending of both. And I think our larger neighbor on the north proves that it's doing that quite well.
There is one question on Paravidya, so maybe you would like to, how to inculcate Paravidya among the vast population of our country?
Very simple. If only the teachers are categorized into two. Teachers who give the technical, ordinary education and the teachers who are exemplary in character, an environment can be created. Every epic character, noble character had two teachers. One is the person who has proficiency in the subject, the other to create the moral atmosphere. The institutions should often be residential, and their residential tutors are to be appointed who are very much role models. National Defense Academy, Khadakwasla, Pune, where I was the principal for some time, we have two teachers. One to play the role of a parent to take care of the cadet, the other to inculcate the professional education. Everywhere there must be a parental role to be played by the teacher. If both are molded into one, excellent. If they are not available, professional education with the modern technological devices can be given any time. Amrita University at Coimbatore is doing. All the experts all over the globe are being invited over the screen to give the technical information. And the local teachers play their role morally, ethically. They are made perfect. That proper discipline is inculcated. If only the government of India can formulate certain rules and regulations under the whole UGC Act, the entire system can be revamped and Paravidya can be initiated. Paravidya is to be initiated at the earliest possible, even at the LKG level, with the songs which are not hickory dickory dock, the mouse ran up the clock.
There is also this question about what are thoughts of Vivekananda on women empowerment and relevance today? Who would like to tell that? Would you like to?
Yes. Swami Vivekananda was asked the same question in the West. Every time you speak two words, it comes from the deepmost part of your abdomen, your heart. One, the women of India. And the second, my Bharat. Every time he said my motherland, it was coming, it was vibrating everywhere. His eyes would sparkle, his entire body will be electrified. The audiences also would get energized. There were two words. One is the motherland. The other is the women of India. There is an excellent lecture of Swami Vivekananda worthy of being read by everybody. In India, if at all the glory is still being retained, it is because of the women of India. They are the custodians of purity, he says. If you take a research study, 98% of the women in India even today are pure at every level. Purity makes a woman. Woman is motherhood. Motherhood is godhood. And motherhood, womanhood, and godhood have the underlying character. Purity at the physical level, purity at the psychic level, purity at the intellectual level, purity at the social, spiritual level. It is the purity which is divinity, and woman is the very embodiment of purity. Even today, men cannot be considered to be so pure as woman. Woman is the mother and goddess. That's what the reply he gave.
There is this question to Anirban, Ganguly, and to you, sir. Whether Vivekananda modified Hinduism?
Modified Hinduism?
I think that's what
Sister Nivedita says. He.
I can. Swami Vivekananda wanted modification of Hinduism, and he did it to a great extent. One may be born in a church. One should not die in the church. Hinduism has rituals. Hinduism has the spiritual tower. The rituals are the steps to take us to the topmost tower of spirituality. If we retain ourselves on the staircase leading to the top, we are ritual-ridden Hindus. Steps are necessary. Staircase is necessary. But staircase is not the living place. We have to go to the top. And Hinduism is to be so modified that steps are to be seen as steps and the tower is to be the abode. For that, the major handicap is casteism, untouchability, superstition, etc. If Sri Ram had only one enemy, Kama, Sri Krishna had another enemy, greed, and Sri Ramakrishna had four enemies in the society. One is superstition, the other is materialism, the third is lust, fourth is greed. A boy taking BA history examination in 1920 would read history available up to 1920. Another student who takes BA examination at the age of 20 in 2020 has to read more history. Similarly, as the years roll, Hinduism is getting more and more handicaps, troubles, difficulties, unless it is modified and the syllabus reset, the society will not improve. From the ritual to the spiritual, we have to climb the ladder. Stagnation and superstition are to be removed from Hinduism. In that point of view, Swamiji wanted every individual's intellect to be educated to overcome the impeding steps. This is the modification in principle he wanted. Categorization is unavoidable. Categorization is to be made intelligently. Sri Krishna says, Chaturvarnyam maya srishta guna karma vibhagasu. Similarly, the modern intellectuals should come together and follow a policy for categorization. Categorization is unavoidable. And this categorization must be intellectually based, spiritually based, humanly based, so that every individual, Vyashti Dharma, the entire society, Samishti Dharma, all of them can evolve to the higher heights. That is the modification which he proposed.
We have a question from the Costa Rican ambassador. I can't read the name, Mariel. She wants to know, the West is in deep need of India's spiritual knowledge. We have already reached a point of nihilism regarding spirit. As a student of yoga, I would like to know how a foreigner can contribute to the West. And this is addressed to Mr. Ganguly.
It's a very interesting point that Swami Vivekananda makes. I just want to address that issue about modifying Hinduism. I think Sister Nivedita says it beautifully. Swami Vivekananda created Hinduism. And I think he created Hinduism, recreated it for our age and our understanding. You see, while addressing a very interesting point he makes, he says that I want Indians to go out to the West to speak for India. I want Westerners to come to India and live here to serve her. In one of her assessments of Swami Vivekananda, Swami Vivekananda's and India's national life, Sister Nivedita makes a very interesting observation. He says he taught us to see India not in, and I'll come back to your question, not in the manner that we, not in the manner that we want her to be, but to accept her as she is. And of course, as we were discussing, that most of her, of his early disciples who supported the Ramakrishna movement were Western women. So when I speak about Swami Vivekananda as the fulcrum, as the center of India's soft power, I think he is somebody who at that point of time spoke and made himself understood to a Western audience. And there was, they responded, largely they responded to the way he interpreted India, to the way he explained India. And then he spoke about the cycles of Western civilization. If you read his travels, memoirs of European travel, in 1890s while visiting Europe, he looks around and he says that he can see the coming of a great war in Europe. and this was in the 1890s, 1900, and in 1914 you had the first Great World War. Talking about Western cycles of Western civilization, this is where Swami Vivekananda says, this is where India's uniqueness as a civilization comes. India offers an alternate mode of life, an alternate mode of collective existence, an alternate manner of looking at the universe itself. So I think the cycle, and Romain Rolland says that we are souls in the West who are thirsting for the knowledge of the East, and Swami Vivekananda gives us that, tired souls of the West. I think that cycle has come, and it has come complete. The West, while the West looks for something beyond the struggles of materialism, the East is also passing through that same cycle. And I think Swami Vivekananda's entire message, his life, is there for everyone to really take that forward.
Not only yoga.
Yoga is just one aspect of the physical manifestation of what he wanted to say. But his articulations on life, on daily life, on living, is something which perhaps should be widely disseminated. So I think there can be very interesting modules which not only focus on the physical aspect of it, it focuses on the mental and on the vital aspect of it also, dimensions which are much beyond the physical, and then a combination.
Well, I think we must now wind this discussion down, because he has to catch a flight and he has also to go for another panel. So thank you very much. This has been a very great learning experience, and I'm glad that we had such a wonderful panelists who have thrown light on Vivekananda, his teachings, and his questions about, and provided us insights about what he really thought about Hinduism, whether he modified it or no. And I think there is a lot which still probably needs to be understood. And now you also raise this question of what is universal and what is not universal. I think that's also a very interesting question that we need to think through. Then there is also this question about the relevance for our practical problems as today. I mean, a lot of what Vivekananda has said, it's almost like a motivator, positive thinking for a very school children, college children, you know, how to, I think it's Paravidya is what he's probably teaching. So it's quite clear that there is a lot that we can draw. And I think you mentioned this very interesting point about counter-narrative. I think the world is looking for a narrative from India coming out in different spheres. And often the criticism is that we are slave to the Western narratives. Either we agree with it or disagree with it, but we are not able to come up with our own narrative. And that is why people like Swami Vivekananda and their thoughts become very relevant. And this is the work that think tanks ought to be doing, that how to develop that counter-narrative. And counter-narrative can be on all kinds of issues. It could be on domestic issues. It could be on, as you said, education, for instance. It could be in how to solve problems, social problems. It could be about the world, our place in the world, etc. So there are many, many areas in which I think we need to work. And not only, of course, Vivekananda, but many other thinkers, some names also came up. We must study all this and try and bring that counter-narrative. And that counter-narrative, and that should be the thrust of our education and research, so that we go from aparavidya to paravidya. So thank you very much. I have a great pleasure in thanking all the panelists. Let's the audience also should give them a hand. And we hope that you will join us in future discussions as well. And I'd like to just present a small memento.